David said, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Two men sat in a train as it made its way through the night from Glasgow to Edinburgh, Scotland. One was short and stout with iron-gray hair. The other was tall and massive with sideburns that blended into a heavy mustache. The short man was Dwight L. Moody, a one-time shoe clerk who started preaching from a packing box. Now he had become an evangelist, taking the good news to all the world. The tall man was Ira Sankey, a one-time bank clerk who now sang the gospel in the power of God. It was the year 1874. The train rocked from side to side as Sankey read the newspaper. That was little of interest, and he was about to cast it aside when he noticed a poem in a corner of one of the pages. It had been written by a little orphan Scottish girl by the name of Elizabeth. She had died 5 years before, and the paper had used the poem just to fill a column on the page. Ira Sankey read the lines over and over again. He tore the poem out, stuffed it into his pocket, and forgot about it. In Edinburgh, people crowded in to hear the world-famous team tell the good news about Jesus. Moody's first sermon was on the subject of the Good Shepherd. The time came for Sankey to sing, but he had not been told beforehand what the subject would be. Moody turned to him and said, "Sankey, sing something." He thought of the poem. The words were perfect for the subject, but there was no music for the verses. Sankey put the newspaper clipping on the music rack and breathed a prayer. His hands dropped to the keys. He struck a melody and started singing. These few moments were the most intense of his life. The congregation was spellbound as he leaned over the organ and sang, composing the music at the same time, the 99. The words were, "There were 99 that safely lay in the shelter of the fold, but one was out on the hills far away, far off from the gates of gold. Away on the mountains wild and bare, away from the tender shepherd's care, away from the tender shepherd's care. Lord, thou hast here thy 99, are they not enough for thee?" But the shepherd made answer, "This of mine has wandered away from me. And although the road be rough and steep, I go to the desert to find my sheep. I go to the desert to find my sheep." But none of the ransom ever knew how deep were the waters crossed, nor how dark was the night that the Lord passed through, ere he found his sheep that was lost. Out in the desert he heard its cry, sick and helpless and ready to die. Sick and helpless and ready to die. Lord, Whence are these blood drops all the way that mark out the mountain's track? They were shed for one who'd gone astray ere the shepherd could bring him back. Lord, whence all the hands so rent and torn? They're pierced tonight by many a thorn. They're pierced tonight by many a thorn. But all through the mountains thunder-riven, and up from the rocky steep, there arose a glad cry to the gate of heaven, "Rejoice, I have found my sheep." And the angels echoed around the throne, "Rejoice, for the Lord brings back his own. Rejoice, for the Lord brings back his own." After the song was completed, Moody came from the pulpit. Leaning over the organ, he asked, "Where on earth did you get that hymn?" Sankey merely pointed to the newspaper clipping there on the organ. The inspiration for this hymn and for this picture the artist is now reproducing both came from the parable that Jesus taught in Luke 15, 4 through 7. Jesus said, "What men of you, having 100 sheep, if he lose one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is lost until he find it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulder, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying unto them, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost.' I say unto you that likewise joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repents, more than over 99 just persons which need no repentance." Shepherding in Palestine is a man's job. And when you meet one of these rugged individuals, something is likely to grip your heart. Clad in their rough jackets made of a fleece of wool turned inside out, their bare legs are scratched with thorns, and their feet are clad with rawhide shoes. A great club of oak with a knot on the end is their only weapon that is heavy enough to kill a bear. The shepherd walks with a high stepping stride. His muscles stretch like a steel trap as he makes his way over the rocky country. He is fearless, facing constant danger alone. And often one can see a shepherd holding a lamb in his strong arms. Here the sheep has gone from the flock seeking greener pasture until finally it finds itself alone. The lamb is in trouble. It has lost its footing along the path and fallen to a ledge where it can find no way back. Often man falls into the temptation of sin and finds that he is out on a ledge with no return. Seeking greener pasture, one strays from the shepherd and the flock into the wilderness of despair. Here the lamb has wandered away, perhaps in a spirit of over-self-confidence, ignorant of the dangers lurking in the wilderness. The vulture circles overhead, searching for just such a victim as this stray lamb. At any moment, its claws could fasten their death hold on this stray, and its life will be over. Danger lurks along life's path for you today. The Bible pictures the devil not as a soaring vulture, but as a roaring lion going out upon the earth, hunting its prey, seeking whom he may devour. Outside the shepherd's care, there is a desert where you are open to Satan's devices, which will lead you to destruction. The lamb clings helplessly to the edge of nothing with the night in a storm shutting in as the hungry vulture circles nearer and nearer. Hope is almost gone. But there's a voice echoing through the valley. It is the voice of the shepherd calling his sheep. He has left the flock in the wilderness and has gone seeking his one lost stray lamb. Finally, his sharp eyes find the stray. He digs the point of his shepherd's crook into the mountain's rocky side to sustain himself while he reaches far out with his strong outstretched arm to reach his lost lamb and pull him back to safety, away from the night, away from the cliff, away from the vulture, and back to the fellowship of the fold. Now he can return rejoicing, for this his sheep was lost, but it's found. The great shepherd is Jesus Christ, who has come to earth to seek and to save the lost who have wandered into the wilderness of sin. Jesus said, "I am the good shepherd." The good shepherd gives his life for his sheep. It is the master shepherd that goes after, pursues, and seeks his lost sheep, even risking his own life for the sake of the sheep. But Jesus went one step further. He laid down his life for the sheep. Jesus said, "I lay down my life for the sheep." The Bible says, "All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way." Also, it declares that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God and the shepherd's standard. The penalty for such sin is death. Death by the soaring vulture is what the straying sheep rightly deserves. But by the grace of God, the shepherd pursues the sheep and lays down his life that the lost sheep may be found. Jesus died on the cross in order that the penalty for your sins might be paid and that you might be brought into the fold of God. But the beauty of this parable goes even further. God loves you, and he loves you individually as a real person. It is this love that leaves the 99 in the wilderness and goes out after the one lost stray. God loves you. He loves you with an everlasting love. Right now, he wants to come into your heart and lift you from the ledge of despair, sin, guilt, and defeat to the path of joy, happiness, and abundant life as you walk by faith with the shepherd. It was at the cross that God reached down his great love for you. The Bible says, "But God showed his love for you that while you were still in sin, Christ died for you." Jesus took your sin, your death, your judgment, and your place on the cross. He became your substitute. He reached out to save your life for now and for eternity. Now you must respond. Do you see how the sheep is responding to the shepherd's reach? The lamb is helpless but still responsive. It has surrendered all to the shepherd. God calls for your response by faith as the hand of Christ reaches out right now. The Bible says, "To as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name." Jesus says, "I am the door to the sheepfold, the door to safety, the door to life. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture." Right now, receive Christ as your Lord, as your King, as your Savior, and as the shepherd of your life. Enter the gate right now and experience new life, abundant life, eternal life right now. Allow Jesus to be the shepherd of your life. How does one become a Christian? First, you must realize that God loves you and wants you to have a wonderful new life. The Bible says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Jesus said, "I am come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly." Second, you must confess your sin to God. The Bible says, "All have sinned and come short of the glory of God." That means all men are sinners. God compares all men with Jesus Christ, his Son. Are you as good and perfect as Jesus Christ? No one is as good as Jesus. It is sin that separates you from God the Father. The Bible says, "For the wages of sin is death, which is spiritual separation from God." That is a death in eternity, a death in hell. Third, God's good news is that Jesus Christ died on the cross that you might have this new life. Jesus died on the cross for you. He bridged the gap from God to man. God showed his love for you by sending Christ to pay the penalty for your sins. Jesus took your sins, your death, your judgment, and your place on the cross. He became your substitute. Then after 3 days in the grave, he came back from the dead. In this way, God has clearly shown that he loves you. God loves you personally. The Bible says, God showed his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. This new life in Jesus Christ is a free gift from God. You cannot get it by just living a good life. God's word says, for by grace are you saved through faith, that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Fourth, the good news from God is that by receiving Christ as your Lord and Savior, you have this new life. The Bible says, but as many as received him, to them he gave the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. To receive Christ means turning from sin and self to Christ, and trusting him to forgive your sins, to remove the guilt, and to give you a wonderful new life. It means to make Jesus Christ the Lord in your life. You receive Christ by personal invitation. Jesus says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. That is the door of your heart, the door of your life. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him. Through prayer, receive Christ by faith right now. Begin a new life in Christ right now. Turn from sin to Christ. God says in his word, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That whosoever includes you, if you will turn from your sin and place your faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and ask him into your life and heart right now. Prayer is simply talking with God. Ask Jesus to come into your heart and life right now. To receive Jesus into your heart and life, you can pray to him and say, Lord Jesus, I need you. I'm willing to turn from my sin. I believe you died on the cross to take away my sins. Come into my heart. Be my Lord and Savior. Take control of my life and make me into the kind of person you want me to be. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.